Hey, Richard here, sitting on my porch, talking to you. I'm with the blog Facts Working People, one of the founders of it. You know, I've made videos here and there. And I get a lot of my ideas for writing in the big business press or the bourgeois press, on TV and so forth. I read something, makes me mad, and I write about it. And I'm looking at, I catch up on my Wall Street journals here, because that's the only paper other than the Business Week and a couple of others that I subscribe to. And you know, we've got this complete mess in Afghanistan, and I mean, it's really tragic, because it's that country, you know, listening to Biden say that we gave them every opportunity, but we couldn't give them the will to fight. What a arrogant piece of shit he is. I don't like to swear and stuff like this, but really, really, you are an arrogant piece of crap. He talks about that. They drove the British. They defeated the British twice. They drove they outlasted the Soviets, and now they've defeated. American imperialism could not overcome these guys in sandals. Maybe we need to spend more on our defense or offense industry. And so he's been criticized by Trump, you know, Sleepy Joe, and he's weak and all of that. And he does look pretty weak when you watch him, but that's he's old. But you know, so he's talking tough now. He says they'll seek retribution for the attacks in Afghanistan. Well, you know, retribution doesn't solve anything. You know, if you look at Northern Ireland, you look at Israel, you look at Kashmir, you look at any crisis in the world, tit for tat killings, doesn't do anything. The war on terror has accomplished nothing. All it accomplished, and the major first impulse for it, was to overcome the Vietnam syndrome. The US was defeated by the Vietnamese. It was a real blow for them, US imperialism. They had little exhibitions out there in Panama and Grenada and so forth, and other stuff that they do. And so after the 9/11, it was a real opportunity to test their resolve again. They failed in Iraq and they failed in Afghanistan. But he's still got to convince the American people that we're some tough guys and we're looking after you, which he's not, of course. He says, we will not forgive, we will not forget, we will hunt you down and make you pay. Well, make who pay? This was one, and the Pentagon has admitted now, it was a guy with a bomb strapped to him. It's a suicide bomber. Who are you going to make pay? We've killed, the US imperialism has killed thousands upon thousands of civilians throughout the Middle East, probably hundreds of thousands, probably over a million people, with its drones, bomb weddings, funerals, schools, hospitals. That's what the US government does abroad. In our name, and then appeals to us on a nationalist basis. We're all in this together. They were a threat to you. No, they weren't a threat to me. And so he's got to talk tough, and now he's threatening to a retribution against these people. And it reminds me of you know, when the death penalty people. I mean, I'm against the death penalty. I always used to say it depends who does the judging and who does the killing. Right, I mean, Kissinger's alive and doing very well. Rich people, Bush, Rumsfeld, all of the presidents of America are really killers, to be honest with you. The death penalty depends who does the judging and who does the killing. But in general, I'm opposed to it because it's just working class people that die. I mean, as if it matters to when you're talking about real criminals or really sick people, like Jeffrey Dahmer, the guy that would cook people up and eat them. Do you think he's worried that you're going to threaten him with the death penalty? It's no deterrent whatsoever. So this one goes on. He says, the president warned last, this is the journal's article, the president warned last week that any attack on our forces or disruption of our operations at the airport will be met with a swift and forceful response. They said that 20 years ago. It's just rhetoric. It's just rhetoric. Not only have they slaughtered people abroad. The US lost about 2,500 people there, which is peanuts compared to what other people lose. If these wars, they're not really wars, they're interventions and predatory interventions on the part of US imperialism globally. If there was a draft, these wars are not very popular at all. It's a small section of American society and their families that pay for this. That's why they can get away with it. That's why they can get away with doing it. There'd be protests about it if there was some, our people were dying. It's just other people that die, that's the thing. And so he's now talking about we will swift and forceful response. Trump said it, Obama said it, Bush said it. They all say it. They failed there. They're not going to beat these guys, and it's just rhetoric. Meanwhile, at home, there's massive poverty. Something over 40% of the population, 46% of the population, can't afford a one-room apartment. I live in California. I was out in a little 12, 15 mile east of here this morning. I could barely breathe because of the fires, which have predominantly been caused by the energy industry we have here. Pacific Gas and Electric is private. They won't nationalize it. They wouldn't put the electrical cables underground and so forth. And so we've got this real crisis at home, housing, lack of opportunity, depression. It's just rampant in US society. I'm very fortunate. I had a decent job, a union job, public sector job, and everything else. And just listen to this nonsense. And part of the problem is, of course, we have no political voice. Working people have no voice here politically. Some black guy said to me, and white people have said to me too, oh God, these white workers have voted for Trump. Well, 100 million people didn't vote in 2016, close to it. A lot of them are white, Europeans, are white people. People, the biggest block really, is those that have given up. And there's crap loads of them that vote Democratic. They hold their nose and they say, well, it's better than Trump. I just voted against this recall in California because Trump, Larry Elder, or one of those conservatives get in, these nutcases, it is going to be very much harder on working people. There's no doubt about it. On the fundamentals, things won't change. The Democrats are as bad. But that's the big problem. We have no political voice. The trade union leaders, I call them the dogs that never bark. They are absolutely worthless. They are rotten. They're not corrupt in the sense there's corruption. I've written about it many times. The biggest problem is that they accept capitalism, they worship the market, and when capitalism goes into crisis, they move to stabilize it and to bail it out, and that comes at our expense. And the expense for all of this is going to come from the working class in this country. And so, there's some nut going up the road there. And so that's the crisis we're in here, and what it's going to show, what it's going to mean. Well, I don't know what's going to have to happen in Afghanistan. It's hard to say. It's hard to say. It's such a crazy situation over there. Pakistan's probably the big winner for that. India's worried about it. The Chinese are worried about it. It's close to China. The US is the, what do you call it, an ignominious defeat. Although, so all of this physical, they might go bomb some little island somewhere or some a tin pot dictator, who knows, just to get it out of their system. But that's the big crisis we're having. We have no political voice, we have no mass movement that we can join, a direct action movement that can force a change here. So the movement, when it comes and as it comes, is going to be very confused, it's going to be volatile, but lessons will be learned through it, just like there has been through the Black Lives Matter and so forth. Every opportunist, petty bourgeois, political opportunist will come into the workers' movement and try to tame it. The trade union leadership will always do that. They did it after Seattle, sent their staffers and their organizers to tame that direct action network after the direct action network that arose out of that and that was existed after that, to try to temper it and render it harmless, and if possibly drag it into the Democratic Party where it dies an ignominious death. So that's what Sanders has been doing. So that saved me maybe 3 or 4 hours of writing. I'll say that's it for now. Talk to you later.